regularly scheduled council meeting for Tuesday, September 6, 2016, at 7 p.m. at Liberty.
You ready?
Mayor Lowry?
Here.
Mr. McIntyre?
Here.
Mr. Reynolds?
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Here.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Here.
Mr. Craybuck?
Here.
Six members present.
Thank you, sir. All right, we'll stand and have tonight's invocation by Councilman Ethan Reynolds.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, thank you for this great city, Lord, thank you for Lions Council of Me and Fletcher Connery, free and public country where we can have transparency and voice our concerns to our local officials, Lord, and giving us that opportunity for us to continue to make decisions that will best serve you and this community in the future, Father God, which is in the prayer, amen.
Okay, and tonight we use the task of that for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, so the action plan, we'll go first with the regular meeting of April 15, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybuck?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Passes 7-6-0.
Demand we need a motion for the actions on the minutes of the special meeting held August 25, 2016.
So moved.
Second.
You have any comment?
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Abstained.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybuck?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Abstained.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Passes 4-0-2.
Thanks, sir. Moving on, communications are not tonight, and we are brought down to the city manager for Mr. Bush.
Thank you, Mayor Lowry, members of the council, members of the public. I'd like to share the city manager's report. It is kind of brief, this meeting, so I'll just get started. Twin Creeks parcels, noting here, I would give an update. I got some very good news for everyone. Last week, we did send the deeds to the auditor. They were accepted. As of Thursday, September 1st, they were transferred to the borrower's name. So the last thing that I do is I just start by finishing fine-tuning the reimbursements that we're going to get, a background to that. And once we send that all to the county, we will be completely free and clear of Twin Creeks. So a lot of hard work being done, not only during my tenure, but tenure in the past. The council's been involved with every step of the way, but I am happy to report that we're about 98% finished with that.
That's awesome.
Yeah, yeah. And moving on down to informational items. Attached is a local government fund distribution, as we all know. This is money we get from the state. Every year has been in decline. It did follow that pattern again this year. This year, for 2017, we are set to get $24,443.95 compared to this year's projection of $27,000. That's about a $2,550 difference. And back in 2015, we got $28,166. So we do see that trend continue on, but we see less and less every year. So I did want to share with council what we'd be getting for 2017. But again, these funds from the state have been dwindled. It's really starting to hurt small municipalities like our own. So moving forward, we'll just have to continue on. Seeing what we get year in and year out, and try to fight it as much as we can.
Thanks, sir. Questions?
Have we ever actually gone back to the committee that sets the appropriations of where the funds go? I know that when Kim Jones is here, we discussed it. And if we did it, we tried this time to try to get more funds. I mean, the Governor Casey likes to say, oh, I'm a tax cutter. Boy, did he shift the taxes to the local cities and townships and schools to raise them so he could run for president, but it failed. But I just think that it's ridiculous that we continue to get such a little amount, where Springfield's getting 48%. Yeah, the Springfield Township's getting 6%, you know, it's ridiculous.
No, it's perfect timing to bring that up, so thanks for doing that. Reading over this letter that's attached, was it due, and it plainly says, these allocations are based upon the formula that each entity has voted on, sent to the county office. So this is the first year that I've done this, and moving forward for next year, I now know that I could be involved with this. From my understanding of it, there's two formulas that they can use. And last year, I think our former city manager did go up to that meeting and voice the concern with our finance director. If I remember correctly, and this is strictly based off me recalling the conversation I had with Ms. Jones back then, was that nobody knows how to do the other formula. So they stick with this one. So what I would like to know is, what is the other formula? And what are the projections based off that other formula?
About this formula, where are these projections from? No one knows why we're doing this, we just keep doing it continuously. Let's actually look into see why it is on this way.
It's based off population, obviously, so I'm sure that comes into play. I scratch my head with Clark County Park District, 1.2% of it. But again, it's something that we'll just have to look into, and, you know, we'll have to do our best to partner with other people to try to get this changed, especially here at the county.
We're like in Springfield Township, and they're getting a whole percent more than us.
Right. So, yeah. But, I mean, it is what it is at this point, especially for 2017.
Yeah.
Question?
Yes.
All the entities.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Then you have Clark County. Now, does that go to commissioners to search for whatever roads, bridges, what role does that entail, Clark County?
That is something I would have to contact Clark County and figure out. But I'm assuming, if I just make a guess right now, I'm assuming it goes into what they call their general fund as well.
Okay.
And they can allocate it how they see fit.
That's good, then. Thank you. That's kind of what I thought, but I wanted to make sure.
Don't quote me on that. I'll definitely give them a call.
You're probably right. That's what I was thinking, but, you know. Any other questions, Council?
Thank you, Mr. Bridge.
Yep.
And my spot here.
Moving on. Attached is a letter that I submitted to the Federal Transit Administration and the U.S. Federal Highway Administration. For those of you who don't know what's going on, the federal government is looking at combining MPAs, which are metropolitan statistical areas, essentially. What that's going to do is take Springfield TCC out of the picture, and then we're going to be grouped with Cincinnati, Dayton, and Springfield. So we're going to go from a very small planning area to a very large planning area. My concern with that is, how are we going to get our road funds that we submit through grants? How is that going to be affected? A lot of municipalities are sending this exact same letter to oppose the merger. I do know at the last TCC annual meeting, they have brought it up as well, where they're totally against the merger. So the best interest of the city, I did send this letter out. I wanted to share it with the council. But it's not going to do us Little New Carlisle and the benefit to be mixed in with all of Cincinnati, Dayton, and Springfield. Yeah. We're going to get lost in the mix.
Please.
So we definitely oppose that.
Let's see if I understand. Because I try to read this. And
sure.
So let's see if I understand what you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Springfield, Dayton, and Cincinnati is one group for this here, and we're going to be lumped into the big cities.
Yes.
Just because we are a municipality?
Because we are part of the Dayton MPA, Metropolitan Statistical Area.
And how did that happen that way? Is that just over time?
Yeah, the government draws boundary lines.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's called government control.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't want to say that.
But right now, like New Carlisle and all of Clark County, we deal specifically with Springfield TCC, Clark County TCC.
Right.
They know our roads, they know everything about us. Because if we have somebody down in Cincinnati trying to make allocations on this municipality, this much for road repair, or for this much project, I'm scared that we're going to be at the bottom because of our low population.
Sure. Yeah, that's the primary one. We have very low political control.
Oh,
sure.
Zero.
And Dayton's opposing Cincinnati, which they're called, it's OKI down there, which is Ohio, Kentucky, and being in the Council of Governments. Down in Dayton, it's Minor Valley Regional Planning Commission, and up here in our area, it's the Clark County Transportation Coordinating Committee. So all three of these organizations are totally against that merger.
And I feel as though the city needs to follow suit and back that. And moving on, any questions on that from the public? Nope. Moving on, we get a shout out from the General Assembly of State of Ohio Senate in regards to our beautiful playground equipment that we did install. So when you get time, please take a look at that. It's nice to be noticed at the state level when you do things that enhance the quality of life for your citizens. So that little project out there, well, big project to us, little in the grand scheme of things, is really making ripples in the state of Ohio, and we did get recognized for that. So again, thank you for everyone that was involved in that project. And I do believe that is all I have for the city manager's report. I lied. I have one more thing I need to write and discuss. Sorry. Health levy is issue number one on the November ballot. We are accepting donations for the health levy committee, and that will buy signs and other materials, flyers that will be handed out to our residents. We are also seeking volunteers to pass out flyers. So anyone would be interested in doing that. I will put out the health levy committee as soon as we just, I think the treasurer is going to be a citizen, but everything's not set in stone yet. So once we have that contact information, we'll definitely publish that information as well. And I do believe that is all I have for the city manager's report.
Council, any questions? Mr. Owens?
Yes, sir. Go ahead. I had a comment that I wanted to ask you about also.
Sure.
They're painting, the people, citizens are getting together and painting the parks.
Mm-hmm.
And there was a person that posted on Facebook, they're going to paint the park, and somebody wrote on to the park today, I'm assuming within the last little bit. They put, we'll be back, don't paint over my effing art, was this quote. It was like, oh, I'll come over here and I'll kick your butt.
Oh, wow.
I'll go onto the table.
And that's on Facebook?
No, that was on the a park itself, so I don't know if there was any possible room, like maybe kind of watch the area a little closer, because I like paint it, you know, and I don't want to tag. Yeah, I don't want someone to go back and tag it, and it's on the bench, you know, so I think that's obviously something that should be addressed.
Rural Park?
No, this is at the,
New Carlisle Park
right behind
Dollar General?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So there's also no sign of that park, which I think we probably should get.
Yeah.
And then
a lot of people ask what's the name of this park.
Yeah.
So we lost most support.
Thanks all.
That's
Dollar General Park.
Which Jerry Saint Park to me as a child, so that's all that does. So.
No, thanks for letting us know.
Yeah,
no
option. And then have we applied for any grants possibly to get like baby swings?
I'm still looking in the process of that. I haven't got very far with it, to be honest with you. The reason I put other things in front of it just because it's not going to happen this year anyway, so I really wanted to focus it on the fall and winter to get that set up for spring next year.
So
that is a definite need. I had brought that up before in the past. I'm also looking for handicap accessible playground equipment too.
Mm-hmm.
So it is still on the drawing board, but it is something that I knew with the timing that it wasn't going to be installed this summer anyway. So we will work on that over the fall in order to get those back up for spring.
Sounds good to me.
Absolutely.
That's all.
Thank you for bringing that up.
Council, Mr. McGuire.
I want to go back to the tax on the,
sure,
for the health.
Mm-hmm.
Just so that's a renewal, is that correct?
It is a renewal.
We know people are already paying that this time.
Sure.
Okay. And we brought up in our last meeting on what they're actually being taxed on. The paper and everything else that comes out alleges this $100,000 figure. Mr. Collier went online, as I suggested to do, and I'll let him say what he found out about his own property, if you'd like to, Mr. Collier, if you would.
Yeah, in the last meeting, Mr. McLaughlin had clarified what I had put in the meeting, so I expanded on what he had commented about. So I thought, I'm going to go online and just see exactly what he's talking about. So I went on the county auditor side, pulled up my property, it's real easy, and I was real surprised at the difference in what your taxable value is versus what your appraisal is. I think most people think it's based on your appraisal price. But your taxable value is a whole lot less. I mean, some people need to really look at that. That was a great point, very valid point to look at.
And 9 times out of 10, what you think you can sell your house for and what the appraised value on the auditor's site,
through the legislation,
is different. And then what you're actually taxed on is, again, way lower than the other. So we'll pay you to take a look at that. All you need to do is go to Clark County Auditor's site,
mm-hmm,
and it'll tell you what your property address is, it'll bring it up and it'll tell you exactly how much you're being taxed on.
I think actually for that $100,000 figure that they used, you would probably have to have a house that was appraised somewhere around $250,000, plus to even meet that $100,000 taxable value.
And I think.
So it is misleading for people.
And maybe somebody should discuss with the health lobby committee when they do their flyers, since they maybe have different, all right, if you're $60,000, this is what it's gonna cost you, if you're $40,000 or $80,000, just have the different levels, something in charges, because it is very misleading.
Very, I was surprised.
But it is renewal, meaning money, but I'm sure the health lobby committee would do an excellent job of getting it worked out.
Thank you.
Sure.
Counsel, any other questions for the city manager? Want to move on? Thank you, Mr. Brewer, appreciate it. And move on to comments from members of the public. If I have any questions or comments.
Could you go to the podium there, so I can pick you up on the microphone and let us know your name and name and address?
Yeah, hi, Counsel, City Manager, Deputy, my name's Don Hall, I'm a resident of 205 North Scott Street. It's been quite a bit of surveillance, some nuisance calls the past couple of months on my street. One house in particular, I'm sure the deputy will be familiar with the home, I could talk off the record about the actual home in general, but had a couple deputies posted outside my house. I do work in the legal office at Wright Patterson Air Force Base, I'm pretty involved in criminal justice. So I just asked, you know, is there anything we can do about these nuisance calls? We don't have like a full-fledged, you know, investigators here in the city of New Carlisle, or from what I can understand, the ability and manpower to do proper investigations, detective work. And forget the deputy's name, first name is Sheila, she brought up that Dayton does a nuisance abatement program. And I have the ordinance numbers, it's been intact almost 25 years. It's essentially, after so many calls, law enforcement can refer a member to the nuisance, you know, program board or whatever. And essentially, the landlord, whoever the renter is, there is a, if you go through a probationary period, or basically supervised, as long as there isn't any domestic calls, any loud noise complaints and such, as long as they, you know, don't violate any of those things, they are able to stay in residency. However, if they do violate the probation, we would be able to have members, you know, evicted. And from what I gather from law enforcement, I've talked to about four different deputies, unfortunately I haven't talked to you yet, ma'am. But it seems to be a frequent problem in New Carlisle, we have, you know, a dozen houses or so that are constantly taking the Achilles of the deputies, having constant calls every weekend throughout the week. And I just think that it might be something that would help out our law enforcement to be able to do their job. But I do have the ordinance numbers from the city of Dayton, if any of the council would like to have that for further research.
I'm sorry, it's hard to hear, you said your last name was Hall?
Don Hall, okay.
The same ordinance you're talking about, and I'm very interested in that same ordinance, is Fairgrounds.
Okay.
Recently did that same ordinance, and I've mentioned that to you a couple of times, I mean, we didn't get into it real deep, but I really like the idea of that ordinance, just for exactly what you just said.
But landlords are really, my dad owns somewhere around 25 houses in the Dayton area, and he has five in New Carlisle. And the landlord laws are really not very kind right now. I mean, the renters, and there is some logic and some justice there, and I understand it, but landlords are really kind of pinned against the wall, that unless something illegal happens, like, you know, we actually see sex trafficking or drug trafficking, I can't really do anything. So I think this is also kind of a shock to the landlords of the city, that, you know, they really are kind of hindered in what they can do.
I know one of the questions that come up, I think, when me and Mr. Brady talked about too, was, is with that type of program, what kind of legal fees would the city, I mean, what kind of battles is that gonna, you know what I mean?
Yeah, I took some news, and I can forward you some more information on it if you'd like, but it's essentially ran by law enforcement. So law enforcement would be the one who refer this particular address to the program. Now, the ordinances that Dayton and Fairgrounds, I'm sure there's other, you know, I don't know, Tim City, Oakwood, some of these little bit more conservative neighborhoods maybe have more constraint. I realize New Carlisle is not Oakwood, is not, you know, Tim City, but at the same time, I think there is, you know, things that we can do. But it's essentially an appeal board that law enforcement would represent the city. So I don't know if, you know, overtime or what type of manning, typically like Dayton uses a detective.
Okay.
You know, so I don't know for our deputies, if we're trying to be able to you know, defend the city essentially as to why this is a nuisance, why this person should be evicted, but that's kind of it. Like I said, there's lots of literature online that I'm sure would be helpful just drafting something up.
Okay. Mr. Reynolds, did you have something?
No, I don't.
Okay.
Can I get the ordinance number from Dayton, please?
Yeah, the ordinance for Dayton is ordinance 28336. It was passed in 1991.
Council, anyone else on that? Mr. Cole?
I'd like to ask Rachel, do you get a lot of those calls? And is it always to the same houses?
I don't know if we're talking about the same house or not, but I mean, we do have certain houses that we visit much, much more often than other houses. You know, we are hands tied because, you know, we have to legally abide by their rights. We have to have so much probable cause to even enter a house. If we're talking about the same house, I know that we get houses that we get, you know, complaints of just it's a highly trafficked house. We get people constantly walk in and out, fights. People complain that they believe, you know, certain houses are drug houses, but just based off of suspicion, you know, just based off the information, unfortunately, it's not enough to question anybody and to go inside the house to search the house. The most that we can do is provide extra patrolling at this point and, you know, hope that we catch somebody in the act of doing something they're not supposed to. But of course, you know, we sit down the street from any given house and people see the cops down there and everybody, you know, does everything they're supposed to do. So there's only so much we can do, but yes, there are a handful of houses that we visit quite more regularly than most houses.
I know, I used to have one extra one.
Mr. McGraw, could you give us four instances of what you're deciding with this particular house is the ongoing situation with it?
With my limited investigation skills, there's clearly activity going on in the house that's very questionable. Numerous cars going all hours of the night to this particular house, partying late into the evening. Last week there was a call where deputies showed up where a group of teenage or early 20s children or young men in teenage high school age literally met at the intersection of, I believe, Washington and Scott, and there was a fight with weapons. And when we got at a club, and this was at 4 o'clock on Friday. So my wife, who's pregnant, was sitting, you know, at the bay window in front of our house, watching this transpire and calling me, so in which I, you know, notified law enforcement. And by the time law enforcement showed up, obviously everybody had scattered, but, you know, again, I don't know all the particulars of the deputies, but I did talk to some of the neighbors, and they visually saw, you know, the assault and saw there was blood, there was, you know, gash. I mean, it was an all-out brawl. But I'm not sure, again, you know, with our deputies and the, you know, limited scope of what they can do, compared to us being so spoiled at the right path, where, you know, I would be curious if a confidential informant, you know, can we follow these guys? They're obviously trafficking something. There's eight different cars in front of the house and a three-bedroom house. You know, it's just lots of things that, you know, if we had the type of support, I think, you know, you might get lost. Right. But that's where I think the nuisance might be able to help us, is we can't pin down obvious, you know, sex trafficking or drug trafficking, but there's enough of a nuisance that you've disturbed the peace enough that we can now, you know, have the landlord evict the individual.
That is a rental property?
I'm sorry?
That is a rental property that we're speaking of?
Yes, yes, and the landlord can. From what I understand, from what neighbors have told me, and again, this is hearsay to an extent, because I do have small children, I am somewhat trying to stay back a little bit from this home and just kind of watch it with eager eyes rather than, you know, get involved with it. But there is good domestic disturbances in the middle of the night. I did, about a year ago, confront a man in his late 20s, a woman, she was screaming in the street, and just making sure everything was okay. And of course, I got, you know, cussed out and told to mind my own business and go inside my house. Luckily, my temper didn't get the best of me, and I walked away. And it's just one of those things. I think neighbors are nervous about, you know, retaliation. And I think in our town, you know, it is very close, but it is something that people are concerned about. If I call this in, is this guy going to break into my house? You know, we think they're all on drugs. We're just nervous. So that's just kind of the feeling that I'm getting from Scott's group.
I've got a question for our deputy, and I agree with what you said, because sometimes when you file a police report, even if I see something questionable, that can come up and you can research it, and it says such and such called or this address called and saw something here, and there could be that.
was something like Crime Stoppers, or we have something like that, I know Dayton does, but we have that here in Clark County, we can submit it, and that's passed on anonymously, is that correct?
Yeah, we actually have informational cards that we can hand out, if they're available, or you can mail in, or you can send in or drop off, they're already pre-postage, and it's basically a drug tip line, is more or less what it is, but it's anonymous complaints that are sent to the sheriff's office and looked into. I guess if that answers your question.
Yeah, and you said either we can mail these in, where they...
Yeah, the deputies have them, we actually carry them, and they always look like brochures. And like I said, they can be sent in anonymously, anything can be reported anonymously. You know, if somebody calls in a complaint to dispatch and says, hey, I don't want to give my name, but such and such is going on, you know, can it be looked into? Again, there's only so much we can look into at that point. You know, we can, you know, try to stop vehicles that are leaving that residence, we can try to sit in the air, we can try to get that area extra patrol, but there's just, it takes a lot to be able to actually get into the home, you know, to see anything that's going on. I mean, everybody always wants to come outside and talk to us, they don't want us in the house if there is any illegal activity going on. And unless we believe that, unless we actually have a cause that there was something illegal going inside, you know, more than somebody just saying, hey, because of all these cars, I think this might be going on, our hands are a little bit tied. But, I mean, anytime one of those anonymous tip cards gets sent in, it is investigated, it is looked into as much as we possibly can.
Yeah, I understand your constraint for the Constitution. I do appreciate everything you do. It's just, if there's ever extra ways that residents can get information to you, I want to make sure.
Right, yeah, absolutely. And also if I have some at my tools over there, we go.
Mr. Lowe.
Yes.
Now, I realize we're on tape, and I don't know if ask the question or not, and I hope we don't jeopardize anything. Sergeant Miller, we've always talked, and Sheriff Kelly talked about everything we have available to us in New Orleans. I'm a debt and a detective with one of those things.
Yeah, I think
you just mentioned if your cruiser set in,
Right.
Well, do they also know what car that he drives as well, or she will?
Right.
But that might be something to look at, you know, because you're always talking about the resources we have at Clark County.
Right.
Maybe we need to try to get some of them in action.
I got the address. I will shoot an email to Sheriff Bell tomorrow. He's usually pretty responsive when he gets an email from me. Sorry you have to live by that. Nobody deserves that.
No, it's kind of really, closing by the applause of law enforcement. I've seen numerous surveillance. I realize, 12 o'clock on a Sunday, they're probably still sleeping on their hangover. Just a peace of mind for my neighbors on my street, knowing that we had some concerns, and we immediately saw, So thank you all the time.
Right, and if it helps, and like I said, I know that it doesn't fix the problem, but it, like I said, I think we're talking about the same address, and amongst ourselves, amongst the local deputies, we're aware that it's on our radar. Like they mentioned, maybe it's something that we can bring in other sources, what we're doing, the extra footage surveillance, it's not working 100%, so, we'll have to reach out and see what we can do.
I just wanted to share with Don that about 9 years ago when I lived in the city, I lived on the corner of Washington and Adams, and there was a house, two houses up, that had the same thing going on, and it was constant, every day, at night, and we finally pretty much did that situation as what you described. They just one night about 2 o'clock in the morning, had a full blown out fight in Noble Street. And I know what was successful in stopping that, busting that situation, where that's when they were heavily out of the bike controls, and the bike patrol rolled up, and they were watching the house. And of course, they didn't know anybody was there. They witnessed the whole thing. So I feel for you because I've experienced it myself.
No, I'm kind of the youngest guy on the street.
Yeah,
I live with people that are robbers. And so just the elderly people, they're just, they're very limited in what they can do. They're great at looking out the windows, but, it's just a certain constituent. I just feel like I speak more easily.
I'm sorry, Mr. Wiley, with permission. But I like his idea about the nuisance group. Look at that ordinance and bring it to council.
I'll obviously be very honest, and I think in theory what you're talking about is a fantastic idea. Some of the issues I see with us is I would like to see examples of cities our size with our same financials that institute, something like that. Fairborn's a much bigger city. He, Mr. Mayor, did submit that to me prior. My research, I found that a lot of these college towns have those type of things in there. City Dayton is a huge thing, but the big thing that would prevent us from doing it is the beavers. These are not our deputies. These are contract employees from the Clark County Sheriff's Office. They're unionized. So if we have to write that into our contract, we're going to see our contract costs go up. So, and don't, and just forgive me because my mind operates like a city manager should. I think in theory, if it works out great, I'm all for it 100%. I would have to see how Sheriff Kelly's going to have to handle that with his police union.
Is that, Mr. Rose, is that something, I mean, if you looked into, I'm not saying you have, is that looked into a little bit? Is that something worth talking to Sheriff Kelly about and see what?
I mean, I'll be honest with you.
His experience with similar things like that?
I mean, never heard us discuss anything, first off. I just have some issues with how is it going to play out with our deputies, quote unquote, our contract employees going out and doing work like that. Then, if it is initiated, how, depending on how that legislation is worded, if the city has any liability on that, if we can be turned around and be held liable for any kind of wrongful thing that the deputies did on behalf of the city.
Correct.
So I think, like I said, it would have to be something that we'd have to get our law director and make sure this is going to go off without a hitch. And if it can, if it does, I say we do it. Because it will help alleviate, and you're not the only one that we get calls on that have come up, right? There are other people who live in different parts of the town, you know, say they're having issues as well. That's why I like to get addresses, because when I do send emails off to the sheriff, he is pretty responsive about doing what he needs to do. I do apologize for living like that. These type of policy decisions kind of take time to get going. So if you see us working on it and not seeing it going to rate, then you think you should just bear with us, because there's a lot of red tape, I think, that needs to be figured out before we actually put this in the council's approval.
Okay. No, I understand. I mean, I understand our size, our limited budget and everything else, but I do think we have a dog in the fight because the highest drug trafficking is 15 miles away from our city on Miller Lane.
Oh, the traffic?
I've been briefed from a federal level about how dangerous Miller Lane is.
Mm-hmm.
It is. Right. It's unfortunate that we're so close to that, and I mean, I don't know what kind of state funds or anything that's out there, but I mean, it's a major process.
It is, the Miller Lane issue, but I think another big issue is how we're located, and that's 235, which is the direct route from the Dayton. So it's very easy to get illegal substances from Dayton into our city because of that straight shot right up 235. So, again, we're not the only municipality going through this. I think it's prevalent everywhere. The difference is between, does your municipality do anything about it? And I think you coming here today is going to get us moving to do something about it. Again, I just want to make sure, and these council members will tell you, I'm very cautious about what policy I put in place or recommend to council that would have any liability back to the city.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Allen, question.
Yes.
I am totally wrong with you not understand what you said about dealing with Sheriff Kelly to see if the deputies could do that and how it would affect our country.
They're unionized.
But it's police work.
Well, it is, but I can't go to my alley employees and say, hey, do this extra work.
I can't do that.
If they're doing this extra program, it's going to be initiated by our policy. Now these deputies have to do it. I'm not saying that it is or it won't. They have a union that we have to respect.
Okay, and I do understand that, but it's still police work, and I guess that's a part of it I don't understand.
Well, that's something we'll have to figure out and clear up.
Thank you.
Any other questions, Council? Good. Any comments from the audience? Thank you, Mr. Hall. Appreciate the comments time. Very informative.
Thanks.
All right. Any more comments from the public? We'll move on. Committee reports, none tonight, so we'll move on to resolutions. None of those tonight, so we'll jump down to ordinances. Mr. Collier, will you read it, please?
Ordinance 16-36, public hearing in action tonight. An ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into an amended contract with Waste Management for a 60-day extension for trash collection and recycling services in the city of New Carlisle.
Council.
Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Howell.
Motion to adopt ordinance 16-36.
Second.
Mr. Howell, will you?
Yep.
And the explanation of this ordinance, this is going to allow us to have a 60-day extension to put the bids out. The bids will actually be hitting on Thursday. I can't publicly discuss the bid specifications on meeting until those are out. So anytime after Thursday, we're more than happy to talk about it.
Council, any questions, comments? Mr. Carter, will you? Please.
Mr. Rickard?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Claybottle? Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Passes 6-0.
Mr. Sherwood? We move on to other business. We never would, Mr. Carter.
Mayor, on other business, we need a motion to approve Paul Mola Jr. and Sue Thompson to the local board of tax review. I think, Mayor, we do that in one motion for both.
Do you want any explanation on that? When we did the new 2016 tax rules, it had new guidelines as to how to establish a local board of review. So this is a direct result of those.
So we're going to do a motion for both. I have one.
Mr. Mayor, I move a motion to approve Paul Mola Jr. and Sue Thompson to local board of tax review.
My second.
Who is the second, Mr. Craybottle?
Mr. Craybottle?
Yeah.
No discussion. Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Rickard?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybottle?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you, sir.
Under other business, farmers market Saturday, downtown New Carlisle, starts at 9 a.m. to 12:30 p.m. How much longer does that continue?
I think this is the last one, I think.
It's getting close to the list.
Yeah, okay.
Do either this week or next weekend.
I think last week, just last week.
And Heritage Festival Parade, the date is Friday, September 30th. That's when we'll have the cruiser downtown.
Is that right?
Yeah. Saturday, October 1st, the festival actually starts on, or the weekend part of the festival starts on October 1st that morning is the parade. And it continues to Sunday, October the 2nd. Is there anything else you wanted to say about that, Mike?
I'm just curious what kind of festival that is. I've never been to it.
You never been there?
No.
I hear it's on a weekend.
No, I've never been.
I was just trying to say it's good.
I would just say if anybody that's on East Valley, if anybody knows if someone may be coming into town and that time frame, if you can't get on Main Street, that really tends to upset some people. So no one will ever know that they won't come down Main Street for those 3 days. But
especially during the parade where they can't come through at all.
Yes.
Speaking of Main Street, I did get quite a few calls last week when the flags went up. Every time those flags went up, we get so much praise for them.
Yeah. Praise, you said?
Praise.
Why do you put flags up? Tip City has put flags up, Troy's put flags up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we'll put flags up.
We lead by example here.
That's right.
Supposed to call it how I do the smoking, bro.
Mr. Reynolds?
I move that we accept Bill Lindsay's absence.
Oh, yes, very good.
I'll second it.
Yeah, I will.
I'll second it.
Who did the second?
Yeah,
sorry.
This is how many months start.
So the rest is to excuse Mr. Lindsay from the meeting. Mr. Reynolds?
Yes.
Mr. Rickard?
Yes.
Mr. McLaughlin?
Yes.
Mr. Craybottle?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. McIntyre?
Yes.
Motion passes 6-0.
Thank you, sir. Council, any other questions or comments? Mr. Craybottle?
I think this is the right date. If I'm this wrong, maybe somebody can correct me. But there's going to be a drug symposium on the 21st, sponsored by FYI, from 6 to 9 at Tecumseh.
Okay.
At Tecumseh. It's going to be really big. I went last year, and I think you were there last year, too. When I was at the church, you know, the drug symposium that had the professor from Ohio State.
I know what you're talking about. I was not
familiar with that. Okay. And I know Mike DeWine is supposed to be there. You know, he's supposed to be there, and I'll give you a pause. But anyway, it looks pretty good. 21st, isn't it? Do you remember any?
Did we have that on previous? Didn't we list that on some previous agendas?
We might have, but it's not.
I thought we did. I just,
we left it off this one.
Yeah, that's okay. I just want to mention that for that. It was a new event.
Thank you, Mr. Craybarker. Council, any other questions or comments, Bill?
Mr. Mayor, I will adjourn.